Gildan Media presents Your Coach in a Box. Affordable, mind-enriching programs.
Gildan Media presents an unabridged recording of Brain Bytes, Quick Answers to Quirky Questions About the Brain, by Eric H. Chudler and Lise A. Johnson. Narrated by Paul Boehmer. Introduction. Neuroscience is everywhere. From magazine covers to Hollywood blockbusters, the brain is front and center. This popular media exposure has inspired many questions from people who wonder just what is going on in the 3 pounds of tissue between their ears. Answers to some of these questions have been provided by neuroscientists, whereas answers to other questions remain unclear. In this program, we answer some unusual questions about the structure and function of the brain. We encourage you to verify our responses with other resources. We hope you will be surprised by our answers, and most important, we hope to motivate you to ask more questions. There is still much to learn. Ancient neuroscience. Question. Did people always believe that the brain was important? Answer. The brain was not always held in high esteem. For example, while preparing mummies, the ancient Egyptians preserved the heart, liver, stomach, intestines, kidneys, and lungs of the deceased, but they scooped out the brain through the nose and threw it away. The heart, not the brain, was thought to be responsible for thinking, sensing, and feeling. The ancient Egyptians, however, are credited for the oldest written record using the word brain in the Edwin Smith Surgical Papyrus. Greek philosopher and physician Hippocrates, 460 to 377 BCE, asserted that the brain was responsible for intelligence and emotion. This line of thinking differed from that of the Egyptians and was likely the result of Hippocrates' observations of people who suffered from brain damage. Hippocrates also attributed epilepsy to a disorder of the brain, not to a supernatural source. Although Hippocratic views about the brain were adopted by many later scholars, Greek philosopher Aristotle, 384 to 322 BCE, held on to the belief that the heart was the seat of sensation and movement. According to Aristotle, the brain served only to cool the blood. Greek physician Galen, 129 Common Era to question mark, was well aware of the views of Hippocrates and Aristotle. Galen dissected the brains and nerves of many different animals, but not those of humans. Nevertheless, his experiments with animals and his observations of people after they suffered head injuries led him to reject Aristotle's view about the importance of the heart and agree with the Hippocratic view that the brain was the location of the mind. Galen was wrong about his many descriptions of human neuroanatomy because he had only non-human brains to study. Regardless of these errors, his teachings about the nervous system persisted for hundreds of years. More information about the history of neuroscience can be found in the accompanying PDF to this audio program. Reference. Finger, S. Origins of Neuroscience. New York, Oxford University Press, 1994. Question. Did people really believe that the bumps on a person's head would say something about a person's intelligence and personality? Answer. Reading a person's personality, character, and intelligence from the bumps on their head was very popular in the 1800s. This method, called phrenology, was developed by German physician Franz Josef Gall, 1758 to 1828. And popularized in the United States by Johann Spurzheim, 1776 to 1832. Phrenology was built on the idea that the distinct personality characteristics are located in specific areas of the brain, and bumps or dents on the skull reflected the strength or weakness of these brain areas. Gall used the skulls of prominent writers, scholars, and politicians, as well as criminals and people with cognitive problems to construct his model, because he thought specific traits and their cranial roadmaps would be more apparent in these individuals. His original maps had 27 different personality characteristics, including pride, cunning, wisdom, poetic talent, memory for people, memory for words, and sense of numbers. Spurzheim later added 8 more characteristics to the map. By feeling a person's skull, phrenologists believed they could deduce that person's character and personality. The reading could be used to help people improve themselves. Of course, not everyone was impressed with phrenology. Critics pointed out that injuries to the brain did not result in behavioral changes associated with the skull maps. Other scientists, such as French physiologist Jean-Pierre Flourens, 1794 to 1857, argued against the notion that the cerebral cortex had specific functions at all. Rather, he promoted the idea that all areas of the cerebral cortex functioned equally. Flourens was right about phrenology, but wrong about the cortex. The idea of phrenology seems strange to us now, and indeed, it was eventually completely debunked by the scientific community. But it did promote the scientifically correct idea that different parts of the brain were specialized for different functions. Question: has a neuroscientist ever won a Nobel Prize? Answer: neuroscientists have received their share of Nobel Prizes in physiology or medicine. In fact, 60 neuroscientists have been awarded, individually or shared, a Nobel Prize since the first prize was given in 1901. The first neuroscientists to win were Camillo Golgi, 1843 to 1926, and Santiago Ramón y Cajal, 1852 to 1934. Although they were scientific rivals because of their differing opinions about how neurons formed connections, Golgi and Cajal shared the 1906 Nobel Prize in Physiology or Medicine for their work describing the structure of the nervous system, although they didn't share it graciously. Cajal's theory about a gap between neurons was eventually proven to be mostly correct. Later neuroscientists were recognized with Nobel Prizes for their studies about neurological disorders, hearing, vision, smell, neurochemistry, brain imaging, and neurotransmission. The 1949 prize given to Antonio Egas Moniz, 1874 to 1955, was very controversial because of its focus on the development of the lobotomy to treat mental illness. In retrospect, the award to Moniz seems like a poor choice, but the prize has not been retracted. The most recent neuroscientists to win the Nobel Prize are John O'Keefe, born 1939, Edvard I. Moser, born 1962, and May Britt Moser, born 1963, who won in 2014 for their work on the spatial navigation system in the brain. For a list of all neuroscientists who have won the Nobel Prize in Physiology or Medicine, please refer to the PDF file attached with this program. Question: how did scientists learn that nerve cells used chemical messages? Answer: some people, such as German scientist Émile Dubois-Raymond, 1818 to 1896, are ahead of their time. In the late 1800s, Dubois-Raymond proposed that nerve cells could communicate with muscles using chemicals. At the time, no one took notice of his theory. Researchers were still debating whether nerve cells made electrical or chemical connections. It was not until the early 1900s when scientists started to test the effects of drugs on the autonomic nervous system that Dubois-Raymond's ideas were confirmed. For example, English pharmacologist Henry Hallett Dale, 1875 to 1968, experimented with ergot, a fungus that grows on rye plants. He found that ergot could block the effects of adrenaline and that other drugs could reproduce the effects of adrenaline. Dale was hesitant to call these drugs chemical messengers, neurotransmitters, because he did not know if the body contained these chemicals naturally. Enter German pharmacologist Otto Loewi, 1873-1961. He knew of Dale's work and conducted his own research into how drugs affected the function of glands and internal organs. In 1921, Loewi went to sleep one night and dreamed of an experiment that would revolutionize our understanding of the nervous system. When he woke up in the middle of the night, he wrote down the important experiment and then went back to sleep. The next morning, when he arose, he could not read his own writing and could not remember the contents of his dream. As luck would have it, Loewi had the same dream of the experiment the next night. This time, when he woke from his dream, he did not take any chances. He went straight to his laboratory to do the experiment. In this experiment, Loewi took one frog heart that was still connected to the vagus nerve. This heart was put into a container with fluid. The container with the heart was connected to a second container that held another frog heart, such that the fluid from the first container could flow into the second container. When Loewi electrically stimulated the vagus nerve of the first heart slowed down. Interestingly, after a short time, the rate of the second heart that received fluid from the container holding the first heart also slowed down. Loewi's conclusion was that the vagus nerve released a chemical into the first container that then affected the heart in the second container. He named this chemical vagusstoff. We now know it as the neurotransmitter acetylcholine. This is a great example of sleep facilitating creativity and problem solving, although this is an admittedly extreme case. For their investigations into the chemical transmission of nerve impulses, Dale and Loewi shared the 1936 Nobel Prize for Physiology or Medicine. Reference: Loewi, O., From the Workshop of Discoveries, Lawrence, University of Kansas Press, 1953. Question: What is trepanation? Answer: In basic terms, trepanation is putting a hole in someone's head. More precisely, it is the removal of a portion of the skull, which exposes but does not puncture the membrane covering the surface of the brain. Trepanning, or trepanation, is the oldest known surgical procedure. Archaeologists have uncovered skulls at least 10,000 years old that show evidence of trepanation. The practice was quite widespread. Ancient specimens have been recovered from all over the world, including Europe, Asia, Africa, South America, Tahiti, New Guinea, and New Zealand. Amazingly, most of the people who received trepanation survived the procedure, as evidenced by the healing of their skulls. In most cases, it isn't clear why the procedure was performed, although some people speculate that practitioners may have believed that opening the skull would release evil spirits responsible for an illness or disease. Trepanning could relieve intracranial pressure from a traumatically induced hematoma, which would have been therapeutic. It may also have been used to treat headaches, epilepsy, and mental illness, ailments for which the therapeutic value of the treatment is less clear. Although this procedure may seem like an interesting historical note, there is a small but vocal contingent of people today who advocate trepanation as a way to achieve an enhanced state of consciousness. This theory was developed in the 1960s by Bart Hughes, a Dutch medical student and recreational user of psychoactive drugs. Under the influence of these drugs, Hughes became convinced that drilling a hole in his head would allow blood and cerebrospinal fluid to move more freely around his brain, mimicking the state of an infant's brain prior to the fusion of the skull bones. He tested this theory by drilling a hole in his own forehead with a foot-operated dental drill. He considered the procedure a tremendous success and subsequently convinced others to follow his lead, most notably Amanda Fielding, who filmed her self-trepanation in 1970. This film, Heartbeat in the Brain, alternates shots of the surgery with still shots of Fielding's pet pigeon. You can find the film online, but be warned, it is graphic. Fielding is still a vocal advocate of trepanation and has established the Beckley Foundation to fund, among other things, scientific research on consciousness. The attitude of scientists and physicians, however, remains overwhelmingly skeptical about the benefits of recreational trepanation. References: Gump, W. Modern Induced Skull Deformity in Adults. Neurosurgical Focus. 29. E4, 2010. Perapia L.A. Trepanning or Trephines, A History of Bone Marrow Biopsy. British Journal of Hematology. Issue 139, pages 14 to 19, 2007. What's under the hood? Question: How did parts of the brain get their strange names? Answer: Scientific terminology is often difficult to understand. Science is filled with unusual words and phrases, and brain research is no exception. Amygdala, hippocampus, corpus callosum. Why do these brain structures have these names, and what do they mean? Do these and other names of brain areas sound like Greek or Latin to you? They should. Most terminology used in neuroscience has its roots in Greek and Latin. Some words originated with ancient Greek philosophers, physicians, and scientists, such as Hippocrates, Aristotle, Herophilos, and Galen. Other terms entered the medical and scientific vocabulary more recently, as new discoveries were made and diseases and disorders were named after the people who first described them. Some terms are hybrids of Greek and Latin, such as the word neuroscience from the Greek word neuron, nerve, and the Latin word scientia, science. Not all neuroscience words are so easy to decipher, but each attempts to provide a clear description of the place where it is located or the idea it is meant to define. Although some words are just made up, most have a logic to their construction. Robert Fortune provides an excellent framework to understand how medical terms are named, and his design can be applied to understand words used by neuroscientists. Location: structure named based on its location in the body. For example, the lingual nerve is located in the tongue. Lingual comes from the Latin word lingua, meaning tongue. The hormone called adrenaline is derived from a word meaning near the kidney. Function: structure named based on what it does. The abducens nerve, for example, is from a Latin word meaning drawing away, because this nerve controls an eye muscle responsible for moving the eye horizontally. Resemblance: structure named based on what it resembles. Resemblance is perhaps the most common method for naming neuroanatomical structures. Examples include arachnoid, spider web-like, hippocampus, seahorse or sea monster, amygdala, almond, pineal, pine cone, and cauda equina, horse's tail. Characteristics: structure named based on its shape, size, texture, number, or color. Melanin, black, lenticular, lens-like, and ceruleus, blue, are all neuroscientific words based on their characteristics. Eponym: diseases, instruments, or structures named after the people who discovered, invented, or described them. Parkinson's disease, for example, was named after James Parkinson, 1755 to 1824, the English physician who described the neurodegenerative disease in manuscript titled An Essay on the Shaking Palsy, published in 1817. Another neurodegenerative disease, Alzheimer's disease, was named after Alois Alzheimer, 1864 to 1915, who described this disorder in 1906. Betts cells, found in the cerebral cortex, were named after Vladimir Alexeyevich Betts, 1834 to 1894. Purkinje cells, located in the cerebellum, were named after Jan Purkinje, 1787 to 1869. Many surgical instruments, such as the Penfield elevator, Wilder Penfield, 1891 to 1976, and Dandy forceps, Walter Dandy, 1886 to 1946, are named after their inventors. For lists of the Greek and Latin origins of many words in brain research and lists of eponyms in neuroscience, please refer to the PDF attached with this program. References: D'Acquapara, J. E. Iano Idaraga, J. O. and D'Acquapara, C. A. Reflections on Eponyms in Neuroscience Terminology, Anatomical Record, Part B, The New Anatomist, Issue 289, B, pages 219 to 224, 2006. Fortune, R., The Words of Medicine, Sources, Meanings, and Delights, Springfield, Charles C. Thomas Publisher, 2001. Kohler, P.J., Brin, G.W., and Pierce, J.M.S., Neurological Eponyms, New York, Oxford University Press, 2000. Question: Do all animals have a brain and nervous system? Answer: Virtually all animals have some sort of nervous system, but most do not have a spinal cord. Those without a spinal cord are the invertebrates, animals without backbones. This classification includes insects, spiders, worms, mollusks, sea stars, and jellyfish. Approximately 80% of the animal biomass, more than 95% of all animal species, and 99% of the Earth's biodiversity are invertebrates. No matter how you look at it, humans belong in the minority. Instead of a spinal cord, some invertebrates, such as jellyfish, hydra, and anemones, have a nerve net distributed throughout their body. Other invertebrates, such as grasshoppers and lobsters, have a nerve cord that runs down the underside of their body. The nerve cord may be connected to a centralized collection of neurons, a brain, in the head of some invertebrates. But other invertebrates, such as jellyfish, do not have a brain. The sponge is an example of one of the few multicellular animals without a nervous system at all. No brain, no spinal cord, no neurons. The sponge does not need a nervous system because its structure allows water to bring in oxygen and nutrients and eliminate waste. A sponge doesn't really need to do much, so it doesn't really need a brain. Brains are very expensive in terms of calorie consumption, far too expensive to have on board for recreational purposes. So, if an animal doesn't need a brain, it's best not to have one. It may seem that humans have little in common with the spineless creatures that so dramatically outnumber us. However, where nervous systems are concerned, we have quite a bit in common, and we can learn a lot about ourselves by studying them. For example, the marine invertebrate called the sea hare, Aplysia, has played an important role in neuroscience. With a central nervous system containing approximately 20,000 neurons, aplysia have been used to investigate sensory and motor physiology and behavior. In 2000, Eric Kandel, born 1929, was awarded the Nobel Prize in Physiology or Medicine for his work studying the molecular and cellular mechanisms of learning and memory, primarily using aplysia as his model animal. References: Borel, B., One-Fifth of Invertebrate Species at Risk of Extinction, Nature, September 3, 2012, DOI 10.1038/nature.2012.11341. Lubart, G.A., Invertebrate Medicine, Ames, Iowa, Blackwell Publishing, 2006. Question: How big is the human brain? Answer: Here are the facts. the average adult human brain weighs 1.3 to 1.5 kilograms, about 3 pounds, the weight of a cabbage. Contains approximately 86 billion neurons and at least the same number of glial cells, and accounts for about 2% of the total body weight of a person. The average width, length, and height of the brain, respectively, are 140 millimeters, 167 millimeters, and 93 millimeters, about the size of two large fists. The composition of the brain is 77 to 78% water, 10 to 12% lipid, fat, 8% protein, 1% carbohydrate, 2% soluble organic substances, and 1% inorganic salts. It takes several years for the brain to reach its full size. During development before birth, neurons are created at an incredible pace, with 250,000 neurons added every minute. Most of the neurons that the brain will ever have are present at birth, but the brain continues to grow after that. A newborn baby's brain weighs less than 400 grams, about as much as a large orange. But by the age of 2 years, a baby's brain is about 80% of its adult size. The increase in size is the result of new glial cells that continue to divide and multiply, and the new connections the brain makes over time. Maximum brain weight occurs when a person is in his or her late teen years. The peak is brief. After age 25, the brain starts to atrophy and brain weight declines. In humans, the largest area of the brain by volume is the cerebral cortex. The cerebral cortex accounts for 77% of the total volume of the central nervous system. The many bumps, gyri, and grooves, sulci, work to expand the amount of cerebral cortex that can fit within the skull. The total surface area of the cerebral cortex is 2,500 centimeters squared, about the size of a large pizza. The sheet of cerebral cortex, the layer that overlies other parts of the brain, ranges in thickness from 1.5 to 4.5 millimeters, which is not very thick. The cerebral cortex is divided into four lobes. The frontal lobe accounts for 41% of its total volume. The temporal lobe, 22% of its volume, the parietal lobe, 19% of its volume, and the occipital lobe, 18% of its volume. The next largest part of the central nervous system is the cerebellum, which makes up 10% of the total central nervous system volume. The diencephalon and midbrain each contribute 4% to the volume, and the hindbrain and spinal cord contribute another 2% each. References: Kennedy, D.N., Lang, N., Macris, N., Bates, J., Meyer, J., and Cavaness, V.S., Jr. Gyri of the Human Neocortex, an MRI-based analysis of volume and variance. Cerebral Cortex. Issue 8, page 372 to 384, 1998. Peters, A., and Jones, E.G., Cerebral Cortex, Volume 1, Cellular Components of the Cerebral Cortex. New York, Plenum, 1984. Question: Does size matter, and do humans have the largest brains? Answer: You might like to think humans have the largest brains in the animal kingdom, but we don't. In general, larger animals have larger brains. As you might guess, based on head size, a cow has a larger brain than a cat, and a cat has a larger brain than a mouse. One reason larger animals need a larger brain is to control bigger muscles and process more sensory information from the skin. The adult human brain weighs about 1.4 kilograms, 3 pounds. Several animals have brains larger than 1.4 kilograms. For example, elephants, bottlenose dolphins, pilot whales, humpback whales, killer whales, blue whales, and sperm whales all have brains larger than those of humans. Do you think humans have the largest brains in proportion to our body size? Think again. Several animals have larger brain-to-body weight ratios than humans. A 150-pound human with a 3-pound brain has a brain weight to body weight ratio of 1 to 50. The brain accounts for 2% of a person's total body weight. A hummingbird's brain accounts for 3.8% of its body weight. An animal's brain size can also be compared to the brain size of what it is expected to be based on that of similar animals. If you know the actual weight of a brain and compare it to the expected brain weight of similar animals, you get the encephalization quotient, EQ. In general, brain weight is proportional to the 2/3 power of body weight. Using this formula, it is possible to estimate how large a brain should be. Humans are at the top of the EQ scale with a value of 7.44. For lists of the weights of the brains from many different animals, please refer to the PDF file attached to this program. Reference: Lee Kimpa, G. Schuchman, K.L. Schleicher, A. and Zilis, K. Encephalization in Hummingbirds. Trochilidae. Brain Behavior and Evolution. Issue 37, page 85-91, 1991. Question: Is the brain a muscle? Answer: You may have heard the saying, exercise your brain. Does this mean you can strengthen your brain muscles? No, because the brain is not a muscle. Rather, the brain is composed of approximately 80% water, 10% fat, and 10% protein, salts, and inorganic matter. Except for smooth muscle cells lining the blood vessels of the brain, there is no other muscle tissue in the brain. Exercising the brain refers to giving your brain a mental workout, such as when you read, play chess, and solve crossword puzzles. Question: Why does the brain have so many folds? Answer: The real question is why the human brain has so many folds, because not all brains are so wrinkled. Human brains are very convoluted. Chimpanzee brains, less so. Monkey brains, less still. And so on, until you get to the humble shrew with a brain about as smooth as a cue ball. Shrews are also quite dim, as mammals go, and humans are quite smart, so you might think there is a relationship between the number of wrinkles on a brain and the intelligence of an animal. You would be right. That brings us to the reason for all of those folds. They allow more cerebral cortex to fit into the skull. The cerebral cortex is the outer shell of the brain, the most recent evolutionary addition that is important for higher-level functions. Roughly speaking, more cerebral cortex equals more smart. The cerebral cortex is about the same thickness in all mammals, except for whales and dolphins, which have a relatively thin cortex. But the surface area, relative to body size, is much greater in more cognitively capable species. Unfolded, the cerebral cortex of the human brain is about 2.5 square feet. A skull, large enough to accommodate that much area, if it were flat, would be awkward to walk around with, not to mention unpleasant to give birth to. Cortical folding makes it possible to keep all those neurons in a tidier package. Question: How is the nervous system connected to the other systems in the body? Answer: Your nervous system is connected directly or indirectly with all of the other systems of your body, including the circulatory, skeletal, muscular, reproductive, digestive, urinary, integumentary, skin, hair, lymphatic, endocrine, and respiratory systems. Communication between the nervous system, brain, spinal cord, nerves, and other body systems is a two-way street with signals going to and from the brain and other parts of the body. A good example of this reciprocal communication is between the nervous system and the muscular system. To move your arms and legs, your brain must send signals down to the brain stem, where they cross to the other side of your body. The signals then continue down to the spinal cord, where they communicate with motor neurons. Motor neurons send signals through their axons to muscles telling them to contract. Sensory receptors in muscles send signals back into the nervous system with information about the state of the muscle. The brain uses this information from muscles to adjust the amount of muscle contraction. This regular talk between the nervous system and muscular system allows you to hold objects with the proper grip strength so you don't drop anything. Yet, you can hold objects tightly and not crush them. The connections between the nervous system and other body systems are also two-way streets. For example, the brain controls heart rate, circulatory system, moves bones, skeletal system, controls the release of hormones, endocrine system, stimulates defense mechanisms, lymphatic system, regulates breathing rate, respiratory system, and controls feeding and drinking behavior, digestive system, mating behavior, reproductive system, and elimination, urinary system. The nervous system even controls muscles connected to hairs on the skin. In turn, body systems send sensory information back into the nervous system to provide feedback about internal organs. Question: how are the two halves of the brain connected? Answer: the corpus callosum is a large band of approximately 200 million nerve fibers, axons, that connects the right and left hemispheres of the brain. This connection allows the transfer of information between the right and left sides and helps coordinate the activities of the brain. Although most people have a corpus callosum, a rare condition called congenital agenesis of the corpus callosum occurs, in which people are born with a partial or completely absent corpus callosum. The symptoms of this disorder can be mild or severe, depending on other brain abnormalities associated with the condition. Some people without a corpus callosum have normal intelligence, but others have severe cognitive impairment, seizures, or movement problems. Some people who have epileptic seizures that cannot be controlled with medication undergo a surgical procedure to cut the corpus callosum. For reasons that are still unknown, seizures experienced by people after the corpus callosum is cut are often reduced or eliminated. These split-brain patients can no longer transfer information between the right and left sides of the brain because the main pathway between the sides is eliminated.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.